I invite Dr. Arjun Lal Subhanan Rai, PS Manager, PSPC Mandal, Dr. Suraj Mandal, be on the start. Quick. Let's start the session with the sorry for the delay, Fazila. Extremely from the core of my heart.
It's fine. Thank you. Thank you.
Fazila, please go ahead with the case. Dr. Panja, Dr. P.C. Mandal is there, Dr. Saraj Mandal.
Right. So first of all, we would like to introduce National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute, where we all work. And this is a non-profit organization. It's a public-private partnership. And at currently, we have 450 beds. And this is a totally tertiary cardiac care hospital dedicated to serve Bangladeshi population at a very affordable price for cardiac care. Now, we have at present 5 cath labs. Before this, we were having 3 cath labs, and every month we do a huge number of cases. Now, having told about the National Heart Foundation, I would like to introduce my team. And I would just like to say that I feel that Heart Foundation has the best cath lab team in the world, and I love all of them so much. So Murshid, he's our chief technician. He's a great guy, very supportive. Then we've got Leepy, our senior sister, cath lab in charge sister. Then we've got Dr. Kolimuddin, who's an assistant professor, a brilliant guy, is very interested in research. We've got Dr. Ashok Dutta, Associate Professor of Cardiology, and Dr. Ashok Dutta and Dr. Kolimuddin have both been helping in this case today, and I'm Fazila, right? So, and we've got a very, very important person, and that is Dr. Mohsin, who does wonders with our patients so that our patients can sleep. And even if there are delays in live telecast, the patient doesn't wake up. So Dr. Mohsin, and to help us also, we've got Newton and Sister Shathi. So that's us here today in the cath lab, but I can assure you that we've got loads of other brilliant guys who are waiting outside and watching this on the TV screen. So thank you for having us here to do this next case. And without further ado, I would request Dr. Ashok Dutta to introduce the case to you all.
Good afternoon.
Kumara, doctor, yes, please come on the dais.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is 60 years old male patient.
Come on the dais.
60 years old male patient, hypertensive, smoker, non-diabetic, having chronic staph angina. His angina was worsening for the last few weeks. And his ECG shows some changes in the inferior and lateral leads, ST depression. Echo shows normal wall motion with ejection fraction around 60%. So angiogram done.
And
that shows.
Show the angiogram, please.
This is.
It's a left
coronary. Yeah, madam,
you can. No, please, yeah. You go ahead.
Right coronary non-dominant vessel. Left on, left, please. So mid LCX has got moderate to severe stenosis after the OM branch. OM branch has got disease itself in its proximal part. Distal left main is also a bit tapered. Proximal LAD is very tight stenosis and some calcification. You can see even with fluoroscope.
Well, actually, I wouldn't say some calcification. I would say heavy calcification, because you can look at this calcification and you can see it even on fluoroscopy. So basically, we have a patient who's left dominant, and he's got severe lesion in his LAD with tapering and significant lesion in the distal left main. And we've also got the LCX, which has significant disease after the OM. So that's our patient, and his vessels are heavily calcified. So we have progressed a bit, and I would like to explain to you what we have done so far. So what we have done so far is, yes. So what we have done so far is that we have, we wired the LAD, We wired the LED, and after wiring it with a run-through floppy wire, we attempted to have a look with our IVUS catheter, but our IVUS catheter would not go. And I would just like to highlight that we've got both the Boston Scientific, which is a great IVUS catheter, and also the Volcano. So we will use both on a regular basis. And then what we did is, since our IVUS catheter was not going, we proceeded to do rotor ablation. So we initially took a 1.25 rotor burr and we did a bit of rotor ablation. And as you can see, the calcium was quite heavily present in the vessels, and it took us a bit of time to get the calcium out of the way and for our rotor burr to pass down distally. Once we had done a rotor run, we then changed the rotor wire for a run-through floppy wire with the help of a fine cross. After this, we were able to take our, and as you can appreciate, there was a bit of a slow flow after the rotor run. Then we were able to take our IVUS catheter, and at first the IVUS catheter would not go, but with gentle manipulation it went down. And you can appreciate, look at the IVUS. Can we go to the IVUS piece? The huge amount of calcium present in the starting from the mid LED, and the calcium was more than 270 degrees, and in some places around even occupying the whole of the circumference of the vessel. We went proximally and we could see that the left main was also heavily diseased. However, interestingly, the LCX ostium was free of disease. You can appreciate the heavy load of calcium. Here you can appreciate the heavy load of calcium in the proximal LED, almost creating a total 360 degree arc, superficial calcium. And then as we proceed back, we find that the LCX is free of disease. And then the left main was diseased up to its midst part. After this, so when we saw this huge amount of calcium, we realized that we would have a tough time just if we attempted to do our procedure based on the 1.25 run. So we stepped up our burr size to 1.5, and then we did another few rotor runs with the 1.5 millimeter burr, and we did a final polish round. So after this, once we had done with the second run of rotor, we again changed our wire, went to a run through, and then we started doing pre-dilatation. And as you can appreciate, as we're doing pre-dilatation, our balloon slips in the calcium. So we used an NC balloon 2.75, and this is the beauty of rotor ablation, where even a wire won't pass. Once you've done a rotor, you can very easily pass even a 2.75 balloon and do a pre-dilatation. So that's what we did with our 2.75 balloon. We did pre-dilatation and gave some GTN as well. And this is how the vessel looked. So that's that was pre-dilatation. And then what we did is we proceeded to take a we then wired the LCX. Even though we knew that the ostium of the LCX was disease-free, obviously we would need to tackle the mid-LCX lesion, which was quite severe, and we did that. We opened up the strut, and then...
put a stent in the LED.
And then we took our stent. We stented from the left main to the mid... We stented from the... from the distal part of, from the mid LED up to the proximal part of the left main. And we used a 3.5 by 48 millimeter synergy stent, which went very easily. We then, after it, we did post dilatation. So this is the synergy stent, 3.5 by 48. And then we went on to do post dilatation with a 3.5 NC balloon. This is how the...
Ma'am, just to interrupt you, is there Synergy 48 or 38 millimeter?
Or Alpine?
No. Synergy has a 48 as well. So that's the great thing about Synergy. It's a wonderful stent, very deliverable, and it comes in like 48 millimeter size as well, which makes life a lot easier when you have some cost cutting issues. So we used a 3.5 by 48 Synergy. This is a Synergy. After this, we rewired the LCX through the stent studs. So this is our one.
Yes.
Dr. Fazila?
Yes, please.
Yeah, this is Dr. Anand Rao from Mumbai.
Hello, hi. Nice to hear your voice.
Yeah. Nice to see you over here. Couple of questions. One is it a routine protocol for putting a temporary pacemaker while doing the left?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I explained in the first case also, we never put a TPM while we are doing rota. But, you know, our technician, Moshed, who thinks about everything, he came up with the idea, what if? So we don't want to be running about while we are doing rota for a live case. So just for a prophylaxis, we put in the temporary pacemaker, but we do not do it routinely. But here also there was some issue, maybe it's a left dominant system, it's a live case, so why not? But usually what we do is we ask one of our sisters to take a syringe of atropine and just put it on the, you know, be on the standby, and if there's bradycardia, she immediately pushes it, and usually things are right.
My second question is it a routine protocol to begin with 1.25 and upsize it? Because
it's not a routine procedure either. For our first case, maybe you were there, we used a 1.5 directly. Here, we felt the lesion in the proximal part of the LAD warranted a 1.25 initially, because the lesion was so tight that we were having problems in crossing the wire. And once we crossed the wire, the patient started complaining of chest pain. And you could see the calcium so heavily there. So we felt that even when a wire causes this kind of chest pain, it would be prudent for us to start with the 1.25 and then step up to 1.5 if required. So it's not a routine practice to go for a 1.5. And the target here is also that you want to give it, you know, you want to polish the vessels. It's not like you want a massive debulking also. So sometimes if required, we would go to a 1.25. And here we felt that a 1.25 would be a safer option and then step up to a 1.5 if required.
But you are taking the small risk of the burr getting stuck over there with this heavy calcium, and 1.25 is known to get stuck up over there. So I feel, you know, when you see so much of calcium, our own experience is that go with 1.5, do a small pecking movement initially, and then don't get into very aggressiveness.
No, small absolutely. And slow. Yes, yes. We also always follow small pecking motions because otherwise you may end up with a Kokoshi effect where your burr gets stuck. So yes, it's the key to using a rota is, I mean, a rota is a fantastic tool for interventional cardiologists, but you have to, you know, give due respect to it. And pecking motion is the best. I totally agree with you. So gentle pecking motions.
Madam, actually, I'm Dr. Pratap. Can I just have two comments? One is actually, when you did an IUS in the first setup, actually in the LAD, why didn't you try an LAD into the circumflex, IUS into the circumflex also? If you had an IUS, a calcified lesion in the circumflex, your intervention in the later stage will be a difficult situation. So if you do an IVUS in the initial phase, you could tackle the lesion in the circumflex in a different way. Your attitude or strategy will be different. Number two question, why you did not try a flex storm after the rotablator before putting into the dilatation? Or what is it's a severe calcified lesion. Your flex storm would have been more cutting and probably would have your life will be much easier in intervention.
So first of all, let me say it's lovely hearing you. So how are you doing? And you should come and visit us again. You know, you promised about coming again, so you should do that sometime. And about your questions, well, first of all, this about the using a flex dome. You know, we don't usually use cutting balloon that often. One of the reasons is because we don't want to become too expensive. But yes, it's a great tool if you think it's justified. Here, what happened is when we took the NC balloon, the 2.75, it went well and it went very easily and we could dilate it very well. So that was the reason that we didn't use a cutting balloon. If warranted, we would use a cutting balloon, but we don't do it that often. About taking the IVUS in the LCX, yes, that would have been a great option. But actually, we were pressed for time also because they were saying 5 minutes, 7 minutes. So it was like that, you know. So we didn't want to, you know, that was another reason that we didn't go to the LCX. But yes, that is, of course, a very good option that we could have had a look in the LCX, mm-hmm. and that would have made our life a lot easier. Yeah. And it's a very long segment, isn't it? It's a pretty long segment. So, sure. But sure, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Prasila, this is Dr. Vijay Bang from Mumbai.
Hi, hello. So,
just have a, you know, very peculiar comment, and of course, your comment, cross comment to that. Usually, when we have a severe calcium, you do a rota, that is the correct thing to do. And I don't see anything wrong in using 1.25 and then upstepping it to 1.5 in a situation like this. But what I can say that in a situation like this with severe calcium, even after the rota, sometimes we need to modify with the either cutting balloon or angiostomy.
I agree with you. And you know, our choice is usually the angiostomy.
Angioscan.
Yes.
Because that doesn't perforate at high pressure.
Yes. Yes. I mean, we prefer angioscan, but you know, it's very individualized, isn't it? What you choose to use. But we do use an angioscan.
Yeah, but very good case.
Thank you. So, we need to check the LCX now, yes. Yeah. Right. Want to go ahead. So that's how it looks right now. Okay. So this is how the vessel looks. So we've seen that the LCX ostium is free of disease, but there's significant disease in the after the first OM. So I think you can have a look in the IVUS. Let's go to the IVUS again, please.
LCX.
Yes. So we've already shown that. So now what we did it after the stent deployment, we again had a look with the IVUS. So with the when we looked at the IVUS, we saw that the stent was fairly well opposed in the distal part. However, proximally towards the left main, there was still a bit of malapposition. So we need to post dilate this, and we have already post dilated this with the 4x12 NC balloon. After post-dilatation, we have not as yet had a look, but when we saw this in the proximal part of the left wing, we did post-dilatation with an NC balloon. Yeah, and you can see the LCX is still free of disease. The ostium of the LCX is still free of disease.
Okay, go ahead.
Right.
Good, Prasila.
So I think what we feel is that we want to put a stent in the LCX, but we don't want to cover the ostia. I mean, this is our feeling, because the ostia, we've already seen from the IVUS that the ostia is free of disease. So what do you suggest?
What the panel suggests, FFR or the IVUS is enough? Yashpal?
Because the IVUS showed that the vessel was free of disease. We can have a look with the and as you can see in the angiogram, also there's absolutely no pinching even after the first stent. The synergy behaved very well, and there's no even pinching. So I don't think maybe we can. I think we maybe can afford FFR right now. Because there's no pinching there. And actually, when Koo did his study, he did it where there was definitely anatomical stenosis, which didn't translate to a physiological stenosis when he went across the LCX. And here, as there's no obvious stenosis, maybe let's have a look.
Ma'am, one thing that is L6 looks dominant, so better to do one physiologic study with FFR.
Yeah.
FFR.
And whatever the obtuse marginal, no, the value of L6 is for the obtuse marginal. There is critical stenosis in the obtuse marginal. Do you want to take care of that?
But I think FFR will be negative for obtuse marginal.
Yeah.
High obtuse marginal.
In this view, it is looks moderate, but mid LCX looks critical. Osteoproximal area is not so critical, but the mid area is critical.
Small
OM is also looks critical, but that can be left on medicine.
Yes.
How much but mid LCX looks critical.
My opinion is, madam, you have to put
FFR a stent
from
negative?
The ostium of the circumflex to the distal part, actually middle part of the circumflex. Then we can see of the OM later on. Just, I think, even if you wanted to put a stent into the OM, you can do a tap stenting with the circ and the OM together later.
Right.
But I think you have
because
to put
the value of the LCX to the margin only.
OM should be dilated with the drug eluting balloon, and then that is the best strategy.
I think finally you should take a call by yourself. Don't take every opinion.
Any role of flexome to use in obtuse marginal?
Okay. Who is for the FFR in the audience? Please raise your hand.
To make it very simple.
FFR.
I think to make it very simple.
So majority want the FFR.
FFR. Yeah, sure. FFR
right now or after the
balloon? We all want FFR.
After the balloon?
FFR to Niyasho. FFR to Niyasho. FFR.
Great. I mean, Prasila, do the balloon, then FFR, or FFR, balloon, then FFR?
First FFR.
First FFR, then
yes.
Balloon, then FFR.
Before giving an injury, we should be scientific that we have a basis to touch that vessel.
Pratap, FFR, balloon, FFR, or balloon, FFR?
I think there is no need of FFR. I think you should go ahead with the stenting.
Okay.
I also feel that we should go ahead with the stenting, because look at this LCX ostia. It's very nice looking. So what I feel is I want to take a stent for the mid LCX.
We reach a new high academically, scientifically. If you do FFR and tell us that what we are seeing or believing is right or wrong.
Right. So if you want an FFR, let's do an FFR. So what I'll do is I'll take the fan cross, it across the run through wire and change it for the
micro.
Je Moshed, am the run through diye to FFR wire na to bhai proximal niye jay. আচ্ছা তাহলে এটা নিয়ে তো লাভ হবে না এফএ
ফাইন ক্রস দি ডান মেনি ওয়েজ আই মিন হট প্রতাপ হ্যাজ সেড
লেটস ডু দা এফএ পার ইজ দা ভ্যালু
প্রো মডেম
The diffusely calcified lesions, the eye impression is not accurate.
Well, actually here, it was not eye impression only. It was also collaborated by the IVUS that we did. We did IVUS pre-procedure as well as we did IVUS post-procedure. And in both cases, we found that there was no disease whatsoever in the ostia of the L6. And this is rather surprising also, isn't it? Considering the amount of calcium that he had in his LAD, the LCX was surprising. Spared. So, routinely, I would not be doing an FFR for a case like this. But as the panel insists and wants to do it, definitely.
Feel that FFR is not, you don't need FFR. If you feel that the still scope for FFR, please go ahead.
Yeah, but
and I was there with.
What I feel is.
Plaque burden less than 70%, MLA less than 4, or a vulnerable plaque. So in Bhalamur plug, you cannot see, but if your plaque blood is less than 70, ML is more than 4, you may not do the stenting in the circumflex, especially if you have negative FFR. Now, if you have positive FFR, you have to do balloon, then the remeasure the FFR.
Exactly.
The circumflex ostial stent is best avoided at any cost if possible.
Yes, we are not planning to put a stent in the circumflex ostia anyway. We are just planning to put a stent in the mid of the circumflex. So there was actually, once we saw the IVUS, we initially our strategy, we thought it would be a double stent strategy, right? But when we did the IVUS and we saw that the LCX was absolutely free of disease, we decided that we will go for a single stent strategy. And then after the single stent, we would go on from there And if there was significant plaque shifting into the LCX, then we would be again consider a double stent strategy. And that was the reason why we didn't put a stent in the LCX. Because if we had put a stent in the LCX, we would end up with three stents. We wanted to, as I said, we wanted to cut costs. And so if required, we would put a second stent, which would go to the mid LCX. And if not, we would not touch the ostia, just put a stent in the middle of the LCX. That was the plan. So, yes. So now we're trying to take... Yes, please.
I have a question about the strategy.
Yes.
I'm Dr. Bangar. So the strategy means I can see a very big OM coming and bifurcate one.
Yes.
And that's a very bifurcation. Both branches look of equal size, almost 2.5 millimeter. So that will require a bifurcation stenting, looks like, from the side. And then you will have another stent coming up to the ostium of the OM, which also and a circ beyond the ostium is also a diseased OM. There is a big plaque there. Not critical lesion, but big plaque there. It may require a stent.
Right. So once we get the IVAS, the FFR done, maybe we can have more clarity about what's happening. The patient has asthma, Sanakita.
Asthma.
Eyeball impression hardly is 65 to 75 lesion.
Microtech to pull current.
I think Fazila will, FFR will take some time at least.
Yes,
and
yes.
Finish with one liter and we'll come back to you. Just bear with you for 8 minutes. Fazila?
Yes,
is it okay with you?
Yeah. Okay. Fine.
Okay.
Sure.
Adenosine will take some time. Jaspal, my big brother.
So can I call Dr. Manoranjan Mandal, Siddhartha Banerjee, Susan Mukherjee, Mahesh Choudhury, Chandran Mishra on the dais, please? So not there, can I call Dr. Subba? And Dr. P.S. Banerjee, please.
I think Dr. Manoranjan Mandal is here.
What take to pull cut the have?
Good afternoon, everybody. In fact, it's my pleasure to be here in this SCA meeting. I'm really thankful to Professor Panja and Dr. Hajra and all the organizing committee members of SCA. In fact, I came in the last meeting also, and it's really interesting meeting. This time I will be speaking on balloon pulmonary angioplasty. The topic is very new and emerging. It was long back when in 2001, the balloon pulmonary angioplasty were done. I will not go into details of angioplasty stent in pulmonary artery or like that. The slide, please. I will be just focusing on this one, segmental and subsegmental balloon angioplasty, just like corneal angioplasty, where the new technique has emerged on the segmental and peripheral pulmonary artery of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary artery hypertension. So basically, this is in the sense being done in the few, this one, and some registries are there. There were some reports from Narayana Hrudayalaya, although they have not published. This prevents the RV failure and improves the RV function. Otherwise, the walkway, first slide, please.
So
one case we did pulmonary artery, main pulmonary artery palpitation long back in 2005, from where the cardiac shock came. As I told you, CTPH, that is the main of this today in that way. Otherwise, it is done in other, this balloon pulmonary angioplasty. Next slide, please.
Pull back, Kurina. I get a record, Kornai.
আচ্ছা আবার করা যাবে, অসুবিধা নাই,
এটা করতে রাজি হওয়া উচিত।
একটা কথা হয়েছে, হ্যাঁ
the pulmonary angioplasty in CTPH, it was first in 2001 by Kenstein et al. 18 patients with inaccessible for non-surgical CTPH. The reperfusion edema occurred in 11 patients.
What a record is that? Do you have a না থাকলে আর একবার টান দিয়ে দেখে দিই। হ্যাঁ,
36 মান্থ ফলো আপ রিপোর্টেড মিন সামনে আর্টারি প্রেসার।
আচ্ছা ডিসটালটা হলো, এখন আমরা প্রক্সিমালটা দেখে দিই। ওএমটা
যে এত ডিজিজ টাইট এটা তো কোশ্চেন করতেছে।
ওএমটা আমরা আরেকটা আরেকটা ওয়ার নিতে হবে তাহলে। না মানে দেখে দেন না।
কঠিন হয়ে যাবে।
ফাংশনাল ক্লাস এন্ড ওএমটা এফ এফ করে দেন। ওএমটা নিয়ে ওরা কোশ্চেন করছে।
না মানে টেন দিয়ে যাওয়া উচিত বুঝছো। কিন্তু এই ওএম তো চলে যাবে মনে হচ্ছে মোর্শেদ।
না ওএম এর করাই তো আমরা দিচ্ছি না।
হ্যাঁ তুলে রাখে নাই
আছে এখন ওএম টা দেখে দিই।
না এখন সময় নষ্ট করে লাভ নাই। হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ ওখানে রিশা রেখে দিচ্ছি সেটা বলতেছে।
না যদি সময় থাকে পরে করে দেওয়া যায়।
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে দাও না, ওয়্যার দিয়ে দাও, ট্রান্সফারটা দাও না,
ইনফরমেশন জাস্ট লাইক
চলে আসছে
balloons are used less than 40 or if they are higher the drug should be given otherwise the complications are more
loose and ha theek hai
more than one lobe may be treated in a single lesion the balloon should be undersized 2 mm balloon is typically taken and then slowly inflated to disperse the waste up to 5 to 8 atmosphere if there is less than 50% nosis repeat dilatation is given 3 to 10 sessions of VPR usually required in each patient there should be an interval of 1 week in between and the number of sessions required depends on the
nature ekhon taratri no stent
and still of the operator it always should be targeted to segmental or segmental of one pulmonary lobe the need for repeated session is important
OM ta kintu onek tight chilo morsher
planning and evaluating potential hazard valid from repeated
I get super chera more critical say na
agar madam L6 stent kore tokhon OM ta amra check kore dibo
oi ibas ano
I think before so that PA pressure
OM ta dokhon micronear
subsequently
pressure wire niye jabo
medical treatment
paper kore dao OM er paper negative asbe
this could include acute or chronic
OM er paper to positive asbe onek tight to
shone hoy na madam
reduce the risk of complication this is just if you see the angiogram the small thrombi are there and the vessels distal are getting less perfused and if you open this with the balloon subsequently the perfusion becomes better which can be seen by the V2 scan and improvement in the hemodynamics and saturation the complications are like pulmonary edema vascular injury rupture hemorrhage hemorrhagic pleural effusion patients undergoing VPA remain the risk of injury and hemorrhage because of wire perforation higher pressure perfusion injury pulmonary artery rupture or pulmonary artery dissection the complications or an immediate result of procedural error can lead to signs symptoms hypoxia or even sometimes right heart total respiratory failure wire perforation most common after this one usually caused by deep insertion of a guide wire into the peripheral small branches if managed correctly while perfusion does not necessarily lead to this perfusion edema Why precision can be reduced by stabilizing the guiding, avoiding deep reception, using CT images to visualize the distally. Tariff may also be reduced, avoiding total obstruction, which require a heavy weight tip wire. In contrast to the immediate complication described, the perfusion edema develops 24 to 72 hours after the procedure. Several types of acute vascular injury can lead to this complication. RP after BPA was initially believed to arise from the mechanism that encountered after pulmonary endarterectomy and later to reperfusion, and this elevation of the perfusion pressure of the dilated artery. Additional microtrauma caused by guide wire, vascular dysfunction, edema, and release of inflammatory cytokines. However, it clearly established that this risk is all more important when the patient has clearly impacted hemodynamic mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 40 or PVR more than 7 volt unit. Underdeveloped bronchial arteries have also been identified as a risk factor. Refinement can be, IVUS can be used, appropriate size of the balloon, soft tip, thick trench guiding, use of non-invasive imaging can help to reduce this edema. Pulmonary edema predictive score based on the flow target vessel has been shown before and after the angioplasty has been shown to predict the occurrence of peripheral edema. Some total change of pulmonary rate growth score into baseline pulmonary vascular resistance. This PESI was the strongest risk factor correlated with the recurrence of perfusion edema. The addition of pressure wire technique to maintain distal MPA less than during pulmonary angioplasty and pressure measurement across target lesion to estimate the effectiveness of balloon dilation further reduce the incidence. It also achieved same hemodynamic improvement with few target lesions treated and in the session it should be performed. Pulmonary artery dissection can occur, pulmonary artery rupture. This can be just with prolonged balloon inflation or slow infusion of protamine to reverse, or embolization with gel or metallic coils if there is a this perforation and hemorrhage. This is an article latest in July 2018 by Nobuhiro et al. Balloon pulmonary angioplasty for chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, a systematic review in which the mean pulmonary artery pressure decreased and 6 minute walk distance also increased. The 2-year mortality of patients was significantly lower compared to 60 patients receiving medical treatment. There was no difference in mortality between pulmonary angioplasty and endarterectomy. The systematic review suggests that BPA improves hemodynamic susceptibility, early mortality, and may improve long-term survival compared with medical treatment in inoperable. The future perspective, the hybrid combined approach, pulmonary endarterectomy for the this one main, and then balloon pulmonary angioplasty of the distal combined with medical treatment may improve the outcome in CTPEH patient. Basically, the right ventricle is being taken nowadays very this one that for pulmonary thromboembolism, right ventricle function, the mortality because of this should be less. As left ventricle dysfunction, there has been a lot of this refinement and other things. Nowadays, for right ventricle mortality, everything is taken care so that the mortality becomes less. I think with this, thank you for kind attention. And any questions?
Congratulations, sir. Yes. Yeah, it's really very encouraging to know that.
Minutes shumai diye chhe.
Otherwise, surgery carries a very high mortality in itself. I got a couple of questions. One is your personal experience in performing this. And second is, sir, usually what we see is that these patients are very sick, hypoxic. So making them lie down for a procedure again and again is actually, it seems, might be an issue because they might require non-invasive ventilation or ventilation when the procedure is being performed. And the third question which comes to my mind is that no doubt it's for distal, segmental and subsegmental branches. But at times, these patients also might have lesions in their main pulmonary arteries. So when we are about to tackle the distal lesion, what is the approach for the relatively proximal lesions, which might be actually present at times in these
patients?
I
said, for main pulmonary artery clot, the pulmonary endarterectomy and later on balloon pulmonary angioplasty combined with medical treatment can may decrease the mortality.
I have to push.
Otherwise, for main pulmonary artery chronic, it has not been that way recommended. The patient selection is very important.
I was
to stabilize the patient Shola. And different and 360 degree approach.
Where is it?
The catalyst will be there. Because they should not decompensate and saturation should remain more than 95% by giving oxygen and whatsoever it is. And thirdly, the patient selection at this point is very important. The emerging technology. And if the mortality becomes more, the technology becomes out. Otherwise, for a coronary intervention to do pulmonary angioplasty is not a major procedure, only to have a plan, protocol, and do the very
specific. তুমি শুনতে পারতেছো
না না শুনতে পাচ্ছেন না শুনতে পাই মানে
এত
না ঠিক আছে যা করছি আমরা ঠিক আছে আমরা
তো তাহলে মনে তো যে এভিডেন্স বেসড করতে ভয় পায় অনেক ক্রিটিসাইজ করতেছে তো
अदरवाइज রেডিয়েশন দিস ওয়ান
নাইট্রোজেন
শুড বি ডান নাইট্রোজেন বিকজ মাল্টিপল সেশন উইল বি রিকোয়ার্ড ফর পেশেন্ট অ্যাজ ওয়েল অ্যাজ ফর দা ডক্টর বাই ভেরিয়াস মিন্স হোয়াটএভার ইট ইজ রেড প্যাড এন্ড अदर থিং এন্ড গুড দিস ওয়ান ক্যাথলা মেশিন শুড হ্যাভ গুড রিচ রেডিয়েশন প্রোটেকশন. So both things are important.
Regarding my
personal experience, we had in 2005 rather a case. After that, your hospital and DMC also presented many cases, but we presented one case, right. I think, in NIC and CSI. Mm-hmm. That was a lady with the CVA, IC bleed, hypotension, hemiplegia, and pulmonary artery, big thrombus.
Yeah.
So we fulgurated that thrombus and BP rose from 70 to 90. And subsequently, ventilator was removed and she was discharged on 21st day, presented in various meetings at that time. So our experience was more for the central pulmonary artery. Subsequently, we did few cases other. And there were reports from DMC regarding this pulmonary artery by Bishop Mohan.
Yeah.
But otherwise, this is a very good modality in the sense from main pulmonary artery to the sub-segment, planning in such a way. Of course, combined with the drug will definitely decrease the mortality of this one high mortality patient.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we'll move on to the chapter 8 session. And I would like to call upon Dr. Monotosh Paja, Dr. A.L. Dotto, Dr. Shubhanand Roy, Dr.
Shubhanand Roy, Dr. Shubhanand Roy,
Dr. Ashok Malpani, Dr. Shoro Mukherjee, Dr. Ranjan Sharma, Dr. Anjan Siotia, Dr. B. R. Nath, Dr. Gautam Dotto, Dr. Ajay K. Gopal, Dr. P. S. Banerjee, and Dr. Amal Khan to please come up on the dais for chairing the session. And I will also call upon the first speaker of the session, Dr. Shibba
Chandra.
And before that, I'd like to call upon Dr. Imran Khan to please declare the winners of the quiz competition.
Rajbe abar
bhule geche mone
na na bole ni rajbe
very live quiz competition and the participants are daring enough basically they were the DM and DNB students to participate. Ultimately we'll have the results. All the teams have played really well. I think we have prizes for the third, second and the first spots. I'll go in that order. The third position goes to the team from medical college, that's with 55 marks. That is team B. So medical college gets third position. I think that organizers have a
case. It's a job.
15,000 rupees cash is good enough. So in the times of demonetization. So now the point is second position goes to team F, which is from SSKM, IPGMR. So they've done a really good job. That's the 65 marks. And
LCX.
We are going to
LCX, get madam. LCX.
To at a poker and first place, LCX.
The LCX.
LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX.
LCX. LCX. LCX. LCX.
LCX. In one way, as we played really well in this quiz. And thank you.
LCX. Kunta.
Thanks to LCX.
Upret LCX.
Eta, madam. Ek to plural then, madam.
Prize money you will get subsequently, probably after the
innovation
ceremony.
Upreta jeta abe.
Nicheta jeta abe.
Na, upreta jeta abe. I'm doing nicheta agesi.
Yeah. Dr. Fazila, this is from Skycon and we are live. We can hear you. It's really been a great day.
Thank you.
What have been the findings?
Right. Yeah. Thank you. So what we did is, please, could someone show them the results of the FFR? So the FFR was negative, and negative, as you can see, it was negative in the ostium of the L6. But in the mid of the L6, it was significant. So what we did is, when can you show them the FFR? Yes, they're showing it. So they were already showing it, right? So once that was established, that the ostium of the LCX was not significant physiologically. So this is the result in the ostium. Distally, it was like 0.79, right? So what we did is 0.77. So we then proceeded to put a stent, a promus element we went through the stent struts and we went and put it. Let's show them how the stent went. Can we have a look at how the stent went? So we took a 3x38 promus element, which went very easily inside. As you can see, it just slipped through and through the stent struts of the Synergy. So once the promus element was in place, we deployed it. And after we deployed it, we did post dilatation. And this is the final result. And what we were planning now was to take the Boston Scientific IVUS catheter and have a look at the LCX and how everything looks. Because as you can appreciate, the Boston Scientific IVUS is very, the catheter is very flexible, and we hope that it will be easy to maneuver it through the stent struts. So that's where we were. We've already put a stent inside the LCX. It looks good. And now we were planning to take a IVUS probe. So the things look good. And this is our IVUS. So it's, as you can see, it just slipped through. And that's the beauty about the Boston Scientific IVUS catheter. It's very, very flexible. So for tortuous vessels, for calcified vessels, it works very well. And we were about to just set the Boston Scientific IVUS catheter. And that's it. But you've seen the angiographic final views, which look fine. And if you have time, we can show you the IVUS, which, and the physiology was also normal. And the IVUS prior to this was also. So let's have a final shot. And once we've set the Boston Scientific, we'll just take you there. So it's going to take us maybe a minute or two to set the Boston Scientific IVUS catheter. But if you can bear with us, we'd love to show you the results. And it's been
sure, Dr. Fahad.
And
yeah, please carry on.
Thank you.
We have
so much
time, and we like
to. Right. And just to highlight that this is a case where it was a left dominant system, heavily calcified LAD. We used the rotablator there, and we stepped up with the rotablator 1.25 to 1.5. We used a Synergy for the left main to LAD, and we used a promus element for LCX. We did not stent the ostia of the LCX, and we used, we just want to have a look at the IVUS right now. So, are we connected to the IVUS, or will they need the camera to show it? Right.
We need camera to show it.
Yeah, so they'll be using the camera to show it. Can you just move the monitor so that yes. So, Ashok, you can pull the catheter, right?
Yeah.
Right. So, just hold on. Right. So, as you can see, our stent is well deployed in the LCX. Looks good. And as we move proximally,
OM. This is OM.
Yeah, this is. You can see the. So we've got in. We've got 11 o'clock. There's LAD wire. You can see there. So we've come to the ostia of the LCX. It's, as we were saying, it's disease free, and which we proved also by physiology. It was 0.95, and so we are proximal to the stent now, and you can see the wire in the. And so we'll take it out now. And then if you want, we can, we've already shown you the final shot, but if we can go back to that shot actually, right? And that's us, done.
Thanks, Dr. Fazila. Heartiest congratulations and heartfelt gratitude from SkyCon. Dr. Hazara has given me the duty, and it's from a lady's heart. It's actually been inspirational to see a lady cardiologist perform the cases so well.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Dr. Shiva Chabra. And I would like to appreciate you for a wonderful day and a wonderful case.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you. So just show the picture. Yes. So this is the final picture.
No, just nitro I am giving.
Shabdanidyo. Shumar nitro.
I'd like to call upon Dr. Gautam Dutta to please chair the session.
So this is our final view. Thank you, Theodore.
Can I have the slides, please?
Sure, sure, yes.
A very good evening to all of you. I would like to thank the organizers, Dr. Manatosh Panja, Professor Hazara, and all those who are present here for giving me an opportunity to talk about something which is very dear to my heart.